Okay, so blazing data with Redis, real quickly. This is me. Don't we look so much similar? Okay, I used to be the chief. I used to be the chief technology officer of BNDNA. I'm technically unemployed right now, and next week I start at Desert Digital Media as the director of development for Desert News. I also do side work on a company called Sivo. We make websites for video games. And I like to make and break web stuff, and I like to focus primarily on scalability, real-time data, real-time websites, and APIs. It's been what I've been working on lately in the last couple years. I'll ask several times for questions during the presentation. If you have a question pertaining exactly to what I'm talking about, go ahead and raise your hand. I'll post links to the links, slides, resources, so you don't have to worry about jotting anything down. This presentation is super fast. And the goal here is I could spend probably a week teaching about Redis. And so my goal today is to educate you with the basics of it and inspire you to say, I'm going to go home, I'm going to compile this on my computer, I'm going to use it. And become familiar with Redis that way. So we're going to go ahead and start with a problem. This is a problem that more and more websites are having. And that is real-time data. And I define real-time data as data that you want to write to and read from very, very frequently. And most of the time, your delay on that, you want that to be less than a second or seconds. You can't wait 10 minutes, or else it's kind of old news. And so I love traditional data stores. I love MySQL, Postgres, all those guys. And they do a lot of really good stuff. But for real-time data, they're not the best solution for it. They don't scale as well. They're more difficult to scale. And so, writing is intensive. You're stored on disk. As you grow, a lot of times your data will become slower and slower. And when you go into replication, if you're doing real-time data and replication through MySQL, it brings a lot of challenges that you have to, that just makes it tough. And so my preference is to not use MySQL for what it's great at, user accounts. I want to be able to make detailed queries and reports. I'll use MySQL for that, but I won't use it for my real-time data because it'll melt down. And you'll hit performance problems with MySQL much quicker than with something like Redis. Now, there are many NoSQL solutions out there. They're all really cool. They all do things differently. And you want to use it for different things. And if I was to say what Redis's job is in the NoSQL world, is Redis is built for speed. That is its primary objective. That is pretty much its only objective. Any feature they add to Redis, they talk in microseconds. And they say, oh, it took 100 microseconds. That's too long. We got to cut that down to 50. And so any feature they add, it will perform extremely well. And so a couple things about Redis. It's key value storage, and it's stored in memory. And some of you might be waiting a second. I've had a couple questions about this. And like, well, why don't I just use memcached? Isn't it just like a new version of memcached? The answer is no. There's a lot more cool things about Redis that they have built on. I still use memcached for caches, but Redis, you get a lot more abilities to use it for other types of data. You get persistence. You can go ahead and you can write, if you need to survive a reboot, you can configure how you want to tackle that. You can either do snapshots every so many seconds for every so many writes or updates, or you could do an append-only file. That way, if you can't lose a single bit of data, you have that option as well. You have multiple data types. You don't just have strings. And we'll see why that becomes so important here in a little bit. You have transactions. So if I want to make sure that these 10 commands execute simultaneously together without anything messing with the data in between, you can do that. And there's advanced publish and subscribe stuff with blocking. And so it's really, really easy to queues, notifications, having something listen to a channel and receive an instantaneous response. And when I talk about Redis, it is extremely fast. And when I say extremely fast, it's actually ludicrous speed fast. And when I say ludicrous speed fast, commodity hardware, 100,000 reads and writes per second, not a problem. And we'll show you some of that today. So I can say Redis has gone plaid, and it's a really, really cool product. And I highly recommend it to anyone. Okay, we'll talk about how you use it. It's really simple. Step one is to install and run it. If you're running on a Mac or Linux, compile from source. It doesn't have any dependencies. It's all built in there. You just do make install, and it works out of the box. If you're running Windows, you can download binaries. They're updated pretty frequently. And if you want to compile, best of luck. I've only met one person who successfully has compiled on Windows, and he does all the binaries. Running it is really simple. Just type redis-server, and it'll run. And it has a configuration file available. You can pass it. If not, it'll just use all of its defaults, which work out of the box. If you want to run it as a service, like having a nitd script, there's instructions on there on the website how to set that up. There are repositories out there, like PPAs and even the like Ubuntu and Yum and all that stuff. They have versions of Redis in there. The thing is, Redis is still advancing so quickly that those versions are pretty outdated. And while they'll work, it's much better just to do it on your own. There's almost zero hassle with doing it on your own. And then you can use the Redis CLI program to run commands, and we'll show an example of that. Okay, after you've got it set up and running, first thing you have to do is understand keys. Much like Memcached, your keys must be unique. If you can't share anything, if you I can't want to store some information about Bob, his driver information or user information, then also his friends in the same key, they'll override each other. But keys are binary safe. You can do some interesting things if you want with that. Super long keys are a little more costly to look up, so we don't recommend them. But a cryptic short key like this right here, the U or the PWD, has almost no improvement, and unless you're having millions or billions of these guys, there's no reason why to have it. It'll be a little bit more descriptive.
So where between 15 and 1,000 bytes, or is that where you start? Where's that curve start bending?
It's about probably 512. I don't know. I don't have, like I said, these normally small ones work fine, and you can use these long ones. It's just you will notice a difference. And it depends what kind of volume you're doing. So if you're running at hundreds of thousands of commands per second, you will notice a difference here. But if you're running at thousands of commands per second, so you won't notice. And so, this is the advice that the founder's given. Any other questions? Okay. The next step is thinking key value. This is the part that I think people have the hardest. And this is why I don't recommend actually going out and trying using it off the bat in production. You need to play around with it a little bit. Make something dumb to get your mind around the idea of thinking key value, because this is not an RMDBS. It's all about the keys, not the values. You don't actually have the ability to query. The idea of saying, get me all the users that their first name is Justin. If that data is inside the value, you're not gonna be able to query it unless you run a program to pull them all down and loop through them. And that's very fast, but if you're depending on that to be, super high performant, you're going to have to store that data some other way. There are no indexes by default. You have to kind of build your own indexes, and we'll show the different types of data types you do that with. There are no schemas, and this, you can shoot yourself in the foot if you don't document what you're doing, or if you don't plan ahead, because if all you have is really convoluted strings in there, these key values, you didn't document what they're doing, it'll be very hard to decipher what kind of data you have in there. So that's the biggest part when you're using Redis. And once you start building things with it, you start thinking key value, and then it becomes a breeze, and it's awesome. Step four is we want to go ahead and get know your data types. It's like your Lego pieces. You get to know when I want to use this, when I want to use that to build certain things. The most simple of them are the Redis strings. You can store simple strings. They're binary safe. You can store images in there technically if you wanted to. In fact, I think Instagram does that for some things. I think it was them I was reading about. One of the image things they use Redis and they help use it as a cache like that. It's great for storing JSON. So if I wanted to keep a cache or some type of member data in there, I can store it as a JSON string and pull it out and parse it. And there's a lot of advanced commands with them, more than just get and set. And I'll see the documentation for that. And then the other four, I like to call it my data type matrix. You're gonna have two types, sorted and unsorted, and then you have the other parts. Either you can compare them or they're standalone. You don't compare them typically with commands. You compare them in your program. And sorted is very simple and unsorted. Either it keeps the order of the items in there or they don't. Hashes, they're unsorted and there's no comparison capabilities of saying I want to compare these two hashes. The trade-off is, the good thing with hashes, they are very, very memory efficient and they are very, very fast. They're probably the fastest data type in Redis. Lists, on the other hand, they're standalone as well, but they are sorted. And the cool thing with lists, they're like, you know, lists in computer science. You know, you can append, you can interact with the ends of the list, and it doesn't matter if you have 10, 1,000, or 10 million. The performance will be the exact same, as long as you're interacting with the ends and you're not trying to like find something in the middle. And so they're great for queues. That's what I use them mostly for. And also certain types of indexes, that if I need an indexed kind of data in Redis, I'll do that. Then I have my sets and sorted sets. They have a bigger memory footprint. And when they get bigger, I'm like hundreds of thousands of entries, they are slower than these two. But Redis comes with very, very cool, powerful ways to intersect them. And you find a lot of power in that. And we'll show some examples of that. Any questions on the data types? Okay. So here's a quick guide. Hashes, very small, very efficient. Lists, awesome for queues, doesn't affect performance, as long as you're interacting with the ends. Sets are great for intersecting with the other, and sorted sets are good for keeping smaller indexes of things. We use that to keep indexes of scores for people and for like DNA. And then your final step is to learn the commands. There are generic commands for all data types, for all keys, and then there are commands for each type of data type. And so your commands for interacting with a hash will be different than when you're interacting with a set. Each command has its own big O notation for performance, so you can understand at a very detailed level, when I execute this command, these are the dependencies of how fast that will be. And that will help you understand how you want to interact with your data. They're all really simple, easy to use, easy to understand, and they're very, very powerful. So we're going to go ahead and put it all together and put all our pieces together. Because I'll be giving this talk at a PHP conference in 2 weeks, I will use PHP as my example. I've also found that if you know Ruby, if you know Python, you can read PHP. It's really hard not to understand PHP. But there are there's tons and tons of good libraries for all the different languages. There's stuff for almost every language out there. I almost want to say there's something out there for BASIC, but I don't know.
Where's the conference?
Chicago, PHP Tech. Okay, so first example, we're going to go use a simple cache. We're going to use strings as our data types, and the commands we're going to use are set x, and that says I'm going to set this with an expiration. I'm going to give it a key, how long I want it to live, or a timestamp, and then the value. I'm going to get with this, and I'm also able to set manually, say I want to expire this key at this time. Things are off. There we go. All right. So we're going to use a library called Predis. I should have gone back on the slide. But you have two options with PHP, Predis and PHP Redis. One of them is a PHP library. The other one's a PHP extension. The extension's a little bit faster, but you have to compile it, whereas Predis just works out of the box. So we're going to go ahead and we're going to register it. We're going to create a new client. You can pass it connection string. And we'll assume all of our examples had this done. Okay, so we're gonna have a key, cache.user equals user Justin. My personal preference is I will kind of use these dots kind of like a namespace a little bit. And then anytime I have a variable that will change the key value, like Justin or Bob or whatever, I preface that with a colon. That's my personal thing. I don't care what you guys do. Just make it consistent in your application. You'll make your life easier. I'm going to go ahead and get the key, see if it returned data, I'm going to unserialize it. If not, I'm going to get my really expensive data. I'm going to go ahead and set that with the expiration of 60 seconds. I'm going to serialize it and do something with the data. Really simple. So this is pretty much like using memcache. So we'll go step to a little more more complicated example, and I am going way faster my slides. Wow. We're going to use sets, and we're going to do online users. See who's online right now. The commands we're going to use is we're going to add to a set with the command sadd. We're going to compare. We're going to compare different sets with the union sunion command. Where I'm going to say, hey, give me a union of all these values together, and if they're duplicates, just drop the duplicates. And I also want to be able to expire and pass it a timestamp. So we're going to go ahead, this, in our PHP application, the logic to set that this user's online, we'll pretend that we pulled this from the session or somehow. We're going to get the time. We're going to say, I want to get the minute of that time. I'm going to generate a key. So technically, I will have a key for 1, 2, 3, all the way through 15, or 0, all the way through 59, and then it'll loop over. And so I'll get this key, so let's say we're at minute 0. I'm going to go ahead and set the key and mark that this user is online in this set. And then I'm going to expire this in 10 minutes. And so after 10 minutes, my keys are going to expire. That way when I loop around, they're already empty. Okay? Does this make sense? Okay. Say I want to get the users who are online. I'm going to go ahead, once again, get my current time. I'm going to build a list of keys. Say, okay, I want to get, if right now is minute 5, I want to get 5, 4, 3, 2, and 1. And so I'm going to loop through, build that array of keys. Just, you know, kind of do that, do some logic. If I'm at minute 60, I need to go back to 0. And then I'm going to create a command dynamically with Predis, just the sunit command. I'm going to execute it. And so this command would look just like sunion, and then online 0, online 1, online 2, online 3, online 4, online 5. And then it'll return to me a list of IDs, and I could, you know, count that, or I could do whatever I want with that. And then here's really easy, I know exactly how many users I have online in the last 5 minutes. And it'll continue to work, and it'll work really, really fast. And I could have hundreds of thousands of users online, and this would work. Okay. Man, my slide previews are not working over here, so I have to think. Okay, now let's pretend we're Facebook or something similar. And we want to say, you know, I want to see of my friends who's online. So I'm going to go ahead and use a command called union store. And what that allows me to do is say, hey, get a list of all the people and store it at this location, in this new key, the result in this key. And so it makes it really easy to, you know, do some computations, store it somewhere, and then do some more compares. And then sinter is saying, instead of getting me all the ones, all that are possible in here and drop the duplicates, only get me ones that intersect. And in fact, I think I might have done this. No, I did it right. Okay. All right, so I'm going to get an array. And I want to, let me read my code here real quick so I can remember. So I'm going to go ahead and get I set a key. I'm going to preface it with online users. I'm going to get, say, the user, I'm going to say my user ID is 1234. Get the current date, get the list of my onlines, and I'm going to call this command. And this command would be, and after I call this command, after looping through the keys, it'll say, hey, I want to do a union store. I'm going to store it in online users. And I want to be the people who are in 10, 9, 8, 7, and 6. I say, okay, that's fine. Then I want to say I have a key down here for user, this variable is 1, 2, 3, 4, friend IDs, and say, okay, here are my friend IDs, and compare them with my online users, and tell me who's online. And so you might have, you know, 100,000 people online, and you might have 5 friends online. That's a very performant way of being able to say, okay, I'm comparing my friends that are stored in this key in Redis to who's not currently online. Does that make sense? Pattern? Okay, good. All right. Now, I was going to have a few more examples, but I ran out of time. So we'll skip to the demo, and then we can ask questions. I can show you stuff, and we'll have fun. So we're going to do a live demo. In this live demo, we're going to have one Redis server. And these numbers are actually incorrect, they'll be bigger. I have deployed 42 servers, each one have 80 clients, and so we're gonna have roughly just shy of 400, or about 400 workers. on out in the cloud, and we're gonna see how it performs. So let's jump to my demo. Okay, make you full screen. Doctor Who for the win. All right, turn on mirroring. Okay. All right, so here's my little demo. I called it Fun with Redis. The code's on GitHub if you want to pull it and play around with it. So right here, it shows my current information. In fact, I'm going to make this a little smaller so we can see everything. That's still big enough? Okay. So I go ahead, I have my current mode information. We're currently in idle. I have the current Redis CPU usage. And why is that not reporting the CPU? We'll see. I'm going to have to fix my demo. And then over here, I have controls. And so right now, I have 42 servers deployed. 336 millions are checking in. This is all controlled with Redis. So far, while we've been idling for a while, I've executed about 1 million commands. Our max is 853. And we're currently executing about 600 commands per second. The minions are currently using a polling technique. If I would have thought them out better or spent more time on them, I could have used blocking and push and pub sub and so they could listen and I could send messages to them. But because I was trying to gather stats and it was just easier to do polling techniques, and down the road I'll make it a little more efficient. But for Redis, 600 commands a second, it's nothing. And then down here, I have all the servers that are reporting in. I have their internal IP and their host name, and there's a lot of them. Definitely, this isn't just your normal benchmark. Over here on the left, they can control what percentage of our workforce will be executing commands, and I have different modes. Unfortunately, I only have these two done, increments and random numbers, and once I get all of them working, I'll throw up a video on YouTube or something and show it work live. And so I can go ahead and say, hey, 10% of your workforce, go ahead and check in. And in about a couple seconds, that's not quite 10%, that's actually more 20%. But we have 67 minions that have been activated, and they're ready to do some work. And so I'm gonna go ahead and tell them, and if we scroll down here, yeah, I can see some of them gone green. Say, hey, we're ready to do some work. And right now what we're doing is this increment mode, is we've picked a value and say, hey, execute increments and count as fast as you possibly can. And so this is all atomic. It's sitting there issuing, it'd be like update. In MySQL, it'd be like issuing a update, you know, value equals value plus one. And it's counting. We're executing about 41,000 queries per second. And that's about 67 clients are hitting it. I'm gonna see if I can fix that CPU usage and see why it's not working.
Using AWS?
Actually, I was lazy and used Rackspace. And the reason I use Rackspace is they'll let me deploy 50 servers at a day instead of AWS limits you to 20. And I didn't wanna try and get a special account. Let me just look here and see why. We have time. I'm going to look at my code. Oh, if I can find it. There's Clippish. There's my DNA web. Sorry, guys. All right. And all this code's on GitHub. What the crap? Oh, I shouldn't have tinkered it before I came. Line 22 and 31, okay. I'm gonna do a reset and refresh. What the crap? Okay, guys. Also, It was really cool. The bar would every second would update, but I'll have to just show HTOP. Okay, so we're currently executing about 43,000. And our Redis, just because I've done it before, would be about 3%, 4% usage. And so I'm going to wait. I just did a reset, so I'm going to wait for my master and my menus to check back in. And we'll tell them this starts changing. There we go. And they have all moved back down to idle. Okay. So we're going to go back. We'll do about 30% of our workforce. We'll go to increment. And we'll slowly start working, and our value will go back up again. You know, not too bad. And if I was to go to the server, we'd see, you know, it's not really busy. And the reason why it's only we're capping out at, you know, about 40,000 is the network layer. We're spending so much time in the handshake, you know, handling these, you know, I want to issue this command and coming back and forth. And so Redis has availability for pipeline. I'll actually set it to 10 first. I'll switch this to enabled. And so I'm going to say, hey, go from 10 commands, group 10 commands together, and then issue to the server. So that's, you know, pretty decent. I'll go over there, go to 60%. You know, so we're running at 100,000%. This is a VM on Rackspaces thing. It's not a powerful machine, and it's virtualized. That's not that amazing. And so if I go say, you know what, I'm gonna change my mind. Let's do 100 commands at a time. And we're gonna go higher and higher. It does, so I have reporting on here the latency of the minions. It's taking about 63 milliseconds. So before, that'd be zero. And issue 100 commands. And let me go ahead and update to that to 1,000. What? That jumped really high. And it stopped updating. I might have broken it. I went through this demo 5 times this morning, working fantastic. That's the way demos go. Let me just see. I'm going to keep this open just so I can see if I get any JavaScript errors, which I didn't. Oh, there we go. There we go. Okay. It's starting to catch up. I think my master froze that keeps track of this. So 600,000 queries per second.
I make and break web stuff.
But I mean, this is like a real life demo. This is serious what's going on right now on that server. And I would love to see a MySQL server do this on a virtual machine. The other mode that we have, so we're currently up to 16,000. We've incremented up to that value. We're gonna switch over to random numbers. And so what we're doing now is I'm telling all of our minions, hey, generate a random number between 1 and 5 million, and we're going to see how long it takes us to get to 5 million.
When you say it's incrementing or random, what is that?
Okay, when I was in increment mode, I picked one key, and I said, hey, all my clients, issue an increment number on that number and see how fast we can go. This one, we're now interfacing with a hash, and so I have a hash out there that says, hey, for every number that's stored between, I want to store every possible key value of 1 to 5 million, and let's increment that and execute at this kind of speed.
It's the same key that's incrementing across all of them?
Yep.
So it's saying for key 50, give me the value and increment it?
Yeah, so it's issuing a command saying increment key value 50.
Okay.
And so that's the nice thing. Like, if you're doing this in Memcache, you have to pull it, and you have to do some tricky locking mechanisms and pull and push. The great thing with Redis is because you can interact with it with more features. It allows you to be atomic and not worry about stuff messing with each other. All right, let's see if I can go to 100% and see if we freak out. It might freak out.
So how do these
minions all talk to each other?
So all my stuff that's talking to each other is it all my minions are talking with my server and saying, hey, and I'm starting to lag, and say, hey, just set, it's interfacing with keys and stuff on the Redis server. So it's not only is it doing all this stuff, it's keeping track of what we're doing as well. And then if I disable this, the pipeline again, I should have gone back over here. But yeah, if you look over here, I mean, we're basically using one core.
So is it using Redis to communicate between the minions? Mm-hmm. That's why you were getting commands even then when it was idle?
Mm-hmm. That's correct. Yeah. And so once I disabled pipelining, we're back down to 60, 70,000 queries per second. 60,000, 70,000 queries per second. We'll jump up occasionally. And that's only because we're working at the network level. And the final step of the demo that I would do is you can shard between Redis instances because it's single threaded, there's no multi-threading in this. If you need to expand beyond 500,000 queries per second, you just throw on an additional server and you can shard between them. And you can double your throughput. But these right now in this random number thing, these are writes per second. So even without pipelining, these are some great numbers that you can do. And if your application has the ability to pipeline them, so group them into 20 queries or 20, commands, you can go ahead and send those on. I think I should finish my demos a couple days before, not 5 o'clock last night.
That's interesting to know that those non-existing minions are generating some traffic.
Yeah. So they're probably not. Yep, they're coming back. What might have happened is I might have. I don't remember what I've actually configured the memory for that Redis server, like how much memory I've given it, and so it might have expired. You can configure it, the different expiration methods, like never expire, expire keys that are only set to expire, or just pick random stuff and expire it. I'm not sure what I have it set to, but we actually might have expired the key for that keeps track of all the minions. Yeah, they're coming and going and dying. So I'll fix these bugs, but all this code's on GitHub, and you can look at it. If we're looking at keys randomly generated, how long we've been here before, we've generated, for the exception of 200,000 of the possibilities of 5 million. And within probably in a couple minutes, if my minions don't die, we'll hit 5 million. Any questions? You want to go first and then?
One of the examples you showed was using Redis to cache the expensive query.
Mm-hmm.
Is there an easy way to select one client to run the query to avoid a stampede of cache misses?
Yeah, so what I do normally when I do caching is I will set there's probably more elegant ways to do it, but what I'll do is I'll set it in there, and then I'll have a random, say, pick a number. So every time I go to access that cache, pick a random number between 1 and, depending on how many times it gets called, pick a number between 1 and 50,000. And with my math, I say, hey, that'll happen about every 2 to 3 hours, and my cache is set to 6 hours. That's the way I've done it in the past. It's there might be more elegant ways to do it. You could do something where you'd have something sitting in the background, like a worker processor, sitting in the background, you can add to queues, say, hey, in 2 hours, expire this thing or regenerate this thing. And so that's how I've done it in the past. Because I've had problems where, if I invalidated my whole cache, I'll grind this website to a halt for a good half hour. And so that's one way I've accomplished that. Okay.
I was curious about the pub sub stuff.
Yeah.
So were you using that for like when you're doing the online and offline? Is that
it? That's how I wish I would have done it. Because, so if I tell them all to go idle right now, so we're almost there, it's good enough. So if I tell them to go idle, And I can show you the code too, so you can see what it looks like.
So right now you're pulling.
Yeah. So when I switch modes, I delete the old data, and so that's why it sometimes will. Yeah. I think on my minions, I have some timeout issues set that I need to fix. It's a good demo though to have you guys critique and be like, hey, you need to come back. They restart themselves. Okay. There we go. So these 780 commands, what that is these minions, about every 4 seconds, they check in and say, hey, what mode are we on and what percentage of our workforce are we using? And I'll do some math saying, I'm part of the 50%, the 60%, the 99%, you know, whatever, and say, do I need to work or not? And if I do need to work, I'll start performing whatever task the mode is on, and if not, I will idle for four, I'll wait, I'll sleep for 4 seconds, and then check back in. And so it works, and it's not the most elegant solution. What I would normally do is do something where I'd listen to a channel, and then I could publish to that channel and say, hey, I made updates, here's the data, does it apply? And you can configure it so when you're listening, you'll sit there and listen. And then when the message comes through, and it like instantaneously hits, and you'll get it, and you can then listen to it, and get the message, and then you can decide, do I want to unsubscribe from this channel, or I still want to listen? And so if you publish multiple events, like 10 events to a channel, and it'll get event the first message, and then it'll go back and say, oh, I still have message 2 I need to read, and it'll keep going messages until you tell it, hey, I want to unsubscribe. Even if your code is executing, when a message gets sent out, it'll still receive it.
Does that use like WebSockets?
You can use WebSockets. See, that's part of the reason I didn't do it, because I'm using PHP. If I wrote this in like Node.js, it would have been much easier to do making it event-driven. And I probably will actually one day do that, write all this in Node.js.
There's some really good plug-and-play library packages for PubSub that use JS and Redis.
Yeah. And like, you know, like Socket.io and stuff like that, they have a lot of cool stuff out there. And the reason I run a PHP is because I'm presenting at the conference in 2 weeks in PHP. And it's a PHP conference, so I wanted to be able to show up. But I can show you some of the code here. So here's my minion. And so basically what happens is I'll tell it to run, and I'll run it startup. And then I'll sit there in a loop, and I'll like, hey, get my mode, get my pipeline count, do some work, and then I have some things where, like if you saw me hit that hard reset, I have things where I have it listen to things. So in startup it says, okay, the current reboot ID is 12. And every time I do my loop, I check to see if that changes, and if it changes, I'll quit and let it restart myself. So I've added a few things like that. If you go in here into work, you know, I have some commands I use to get that latency, and I say, hey, you know, if my percent is under 1%, so if I have 0% of my workforce doing it, then I know I need to sleep. Or if my minion ID, I need to make a more elegant way to do this. If my minion ID, if my mod's not the correct, sleep. If not, I'll mark, say, hey, I'm working, and then I'm gonna call the method to do work. So here we have idle, here we have increment. So you can see the code. If I'm in pipelining mode, I'll sit there and loop until I get my pipeline count, and then I'll execute my pipe. Or if I just don't, if I'm not in pipeline mode, I just sit there and issue increment value over and over and over and over and over again. Here's my random number code.
So is the PubSub stuff, is it
we got
blocking? Or?
Yeah, so it is blocking. So let me show you.
So when you're waiting for something.
Yeah. And so it'll block your worker or whatever the thread that's listening, and then immediately when something comes through, I can show maybe, because we are recording. Well, we might edit this part of the video. Okay. So here's the old company I used to work for. Huh?
CA front page.
No. I'm going to my admin part. And our friends list takes forever to build. because we have a lot of friends, because I do a lot of testing. Okay, so here's a system that we have that uses queues. And if it was busy right now, when people sign up to the website, we have to generate their, we use a dating algorithm to generate scores between people, and we say, hey, I joined the site, I need to get, you know, about 5,000 matches. And so what we'll do is I'll put them in a queue, and I have these workers listening, and we don't have any running right now. We got one running right there. I have to manually refresh because it's not cool like my other stuff. But it, you know, these threads report in, and I have 10 threads sitting there just waiting for things. And it is like instantaneous that those things will start. And so we've gone from, you know, our bottleneck is actually our code that produces the scores. You know, and we're able to generate, you know, 76 scores per second. And our timestamps are off on the servers, as you can see. But you know, so if I sit here just waiting, you know, so people go through processing. And we used to use polling mechanisms to do all this. And when we moved to Redis, it's microseconds between you pushing to a queue and the client. Because when you issue the queue, the push to the queue command, it'll automatically go through and say, do I have any blocking clients listening to this queue? And if I do, start popping to them and then let them execute. And so, you know, your queues execute. So if it backs up, that's fine. But if, you know, if there's nothing in there and it's sitting there waiting and you have 10 guys waiting there and you push in 10 things, those guys will start working within microseconds. Your biggest bottleneck there will be your network latency. And so, same thing, and the difference between queues and pub sub is that queues, you push and pull objects, you pop and push objects, and so that you use that when you only want one worker getting an item. And then you can use pub sub to say, I have like 10 chat room clients sitting there listening, and I want to publish that, hey, John said hi. It'll send it all to everyone who's listening, regardless of, you know, how many are, if there's one, if there's none, if there's a million, it'll send it out. I could probably show you some examples.
Well, another question.
Go ahead.
You said that you have to learn to think in key value. The values, how large a data set can you put into the value?
The value can take I want to say a gig. They're very, very substantial. It used to be something like a couple hundred meg, but I think it's up to a gig you can have in there. Like that's the you might run into some performance problems if you have a gig, you know, gig values. It depends on your application, but you know, the people who write Redis is they say, you know, we want to have as few limitations as we can to this, and you know, and you can use it and figure out how to best make it work for you. But what's the difference is that, you know, let's say if I had a gig of data in there and I wanted to get a little piece of data in between, it wouldn't work very well because I have to pull down that whole thing. I can't tell it, hey, get me these bytes in between. Actually, though, you could do that with the keys have some, there's some byte manipulator for strings that you can say, hey, get me these bytes. So actually, technically, you could do that. It just probably won't be the cleanest thing in the world. It'd probably be better to split your data up differently. Okay. But yeah, you can. I think the limit's a gig. Any other questions?
And
go ahead.
You know, since it is just key value, you just got to be a little creative with a key. Like, you know, you could put sub elements in there,
yeah,
to make it a unique key or something.
Yeah. So I can show you like our chat rooms. Here, we'll be creepy and spying on our people in the chat rooms. We'll see who's there. If it's like 12 o'clock at night, we have like 100 people in here and they'd have nothing better to do. So the way this works is we're using polling here. I'd like to switch it to PubSub. But at the time, the polling and the PubSub worked great. The client, the library I was using to build this from PHP didn't do PubSub, it had bugs. And so I just forget we'll do polling, and I need to go back and chat and change it. But if I go over here and say testing, everyone will freak out. There's an admin here with my lovely picture. You want to see that? Oh, I can't click on it because it's mine. But and if I had somebody come in, Oh, someone talk to me. Apparently no one's there, they're all idle. That's what I get for doing it in the middle of the day. But you can see in here when people come in rooms, they're moving rooms, they're disconnecting whatever timing out, we'll update. And this is all done through Redis. And the way we store the posts is we have a hash that has all the post IDs and the content. And then we have sorted sets that say, here's all of the post IDs in order they were posted, you know, up to the last 2,000. And then I can issue a command to that sorted set, say, hey, every minute, go ahead and truncate that to the last 2,000. So if you have 3,000, just drop the last 2,000 off. That way we don't get, you know, millions in there. Man, no one wants to talk to me. I'm kind of bummed. I'm too lazy to pull up a web. I'm too lazy to sign into another person and talk.
So is it? So every operation is atomic.
Every operation is atomic.
So you don't have concurrency issues. So that's
nope.
Because
it is. Yeah. And so it's single threaded. And the only time you'd ever run into concurrency issues is if you were doing things like sharding, where your keys are set apart. Even then, though, that wouldn't be a problem because your keys are equally divided. And if you needed to make sure that all of them execute at the same time, you just have to use a transaction. So, but yeah, that's one of the nice things, is single thread. It's very, very simple. Compiling it is bloody dead easy. And their whole thing is, we'll keep it as simple, as fast as possible, and then let the developers go crazy with it.
And so you said it's all in RAM, so if you do have larger values, you just...
Got to make sure you have the RAM. Now, okay, so a couple warnings with Redis. The kiss of death to Redis is if you start thrashing. So if you go start paging, if Redis instance starts paging, it's game over. It'll slow down to a crawl. And so you want to make sure that you have plenty of RAM, and then you configure it in a way that, you know, if you have expirations in there, say, okay, get rid of the expired items. And the other side, even if I run out of expire items, I'm out of RAM, do I want to start returning, I'm sorry, you can't write to this Redis instance, because you can return that, or you can say, I'm going to start dropping random stuff. And you can do some calculations of, oh, someone said hi. I should be like, sup. I technically shouldn't be an admin because I don't work here anymore. But let's see if he says anything. When it's busy, it just saves full stream. You know, if I had it, it's very, very fast, very, very responsive. But no one wants to talk to me. Probably because I'm an admin, like Royal Bantam. But the other thing with Redis is the way it does persistence when you write snapshots. Is that, I'm trying to remember the correct terminology, but it basically in the Linux, it forks the process, and so it has shared memory, and then only one process keeps the updates. And so technically, if you configured it, I only want you to use 512 megs of RAM, and it's doing a snapshot process, and it takes a few seconds, and if you make tons of changes, it'll actually exceed that 512, because it needs to keep track of those changes until the snapshot is complete, and then once it's complete, it merges it back together, and it'll still stay within 512. You normally don't have to worry about that unless you're doing some really crazy stuff. Like we've had a few problems with that in the past, that we just had to make sure that if we could only configure Redis to use a gig if we had 2 gigs, you know, in case if we had, you know, high intensity writes during a snapshot. Any other questions? Okay, your homework, because we're at UVU, I'm gonna give you homework. Go ahead, and you're gonna go to redis.io, and all you have to do is go download. You can download the stable, or you can download the release candidate. The release candidate, they've added a few things. I shouldn't mention what's on the horizon. They've added Lua scripting, and so technically you could kind of do some querying on the server side. I wouldn't recommend it if it was too complicated, because it's single-threaded, so if you had a complex query running in Lua, everything else would have to be waiting for it. But they've added Lua scripting. They've added millisecond precision expires. They had a lot of requests from people who handle APIs limiting. And so now you can down to microsecond or millisecond say, hey, you know, this guy can't call another API call for another, you know, 20 milliseconds. That way, APIs don't get slammed. Yeah?
So let's just say I have a really small web app.
Yeah.
really small web setup. And I either have one or two servers. We happen to get OpenView and save, or two separate. And I mean, if I'm just dealing with really small instances, gig RAM, I put Mongo on this thing, maybe Solar. And I'm not really in meter expansion. Is it worth it to put like Redis on there? Allocate like a, you know, 100 megabytes of RAM and just use
Yeah. So if you want, for example, if you want to use for sessions, let's see, because like default PHP sessions are disk based, and so they are slower. So if you wanted to say, I want it to be peppier, that it'd be fine. Redis is really well with very little RAM. I have a lot of Redis services that run underneath 100 gig or 100 meg. You know, they have like between 10 to 20 megs of data in there, and it's most specifically for little stuff like that. It says, hey, I don't want it to be slow on the disk. I want it to be nice and peppy. But I don't have large volumes of data. If you have, you know, massive, so if you're handling hundreds of gigs of data, Redis might not be your solution. It might be better to have it be in Mongo or something else. And then if you need to interact with a portion of it really quickly, pull it into Redis, interact with it, and write it back down to Mongo.
One more question.
Yeah, okay.
So maybe I didn't understand this when you were explaining it, but you talked about creating your own indexes in memory.
Yeah.
Is that kind of what the union thing was?
Yeah, and so what you do with the index, you know, so let's say, quick example, I have a list of users with their information, like, so I have a hash called users, and the keys for that hash are the IDs, and it says data. And let's say I wanted to have a list of them sorted by age. What I could do is, like, I have a sorted set. I can show the documentation for the commands for sorted sets. Okay. You know, so you're able to say I have a sorted set, and I could store, you know, with us, because the sorted sets have, you store a score with them, and so you can have the score be the age. And so, okay, hey, this user ID is 46, this user ID is 55, this user ID is so-and-so. And then say, okay, get me the range in the set between, you know, 0 and 10. Get my youngest or my oldest users. And you can do that with different these different commands. And so that's kind of, you have to manage your own indexes like that.
So that you'd call one command and it would load all of those.
Yeah, and so then I would call, you know, hmget, and get me these user IDs. And it'll return them to, and that sounds kind of not performant from a database kind of person, because if I said, okay, give me all the, if I did a query, I said, give me all the user IDs with, you know, and then say, go get me with their based on their age, and then go issue a select for each user, then like nested queries, that's inherently bad. Whereas in Redis, you know, because it's so bloody fast, that, and you can do get multiple values at the same time, that's kind of the norm. And so my biggest recommendation for people to try, a good example, is try to write a chat room or something, simple chat room. No bells and whistles, no nothing, but that's a good example of, I need to keep track of users, I need to keep track of the comments to the chat room and stuff. That's a really good exercise that you'll use most of the commands and most of the data types for Redis. And you can, you know, that'll be fancy. Just spend a couple of minutes, you know, maybe an hour or so making it, and it's pretty darn awesome. Any other questions?
What are some other real world projects that you use Redis in?
Okay, so real world projects. Okay, so GeForce.co.com is it's the gaming tournament we do for GeForce. We had. I want to say 20,000 contestants for the StarCraft II tournament, and we have an online chat system when you come in, when you want to start your game. You come to the website, you have an online chat with the other person you're scheduled against to say, hey, here's my StarCraft or my Battle.net ID, you know, are we still on for this time, whatever. And what was crazy is that, you know, this website would get almost no traffic at all most of the day, and then match night for 4 hours, we would have 20,000 people use it. And so that powered the chat behind it. And for us to be able to do that, we kind of, because a lot of frameworks, you know, they have their bootstrapping and stuff. we created specific PHP files that didn't do any bootstrapping at all, the very core basics, so we could call those very, very quickly. But that's how we handled the pro-am term for GeForce. Another example is for Dane DNA. So if I go to my matches, maybe, watch my demoing skills, because I'm demoing this, it'll take the site down. But here's some people, yeah. I broke the server, tell the new guy to fix it. So these matches are all stored in Redis, and the reason is because I want to be able to sort by my best match, by score, so I have to pre-calculate these scores beforehand. And so they're all stored in Redis, and we're storing, you know, before we switch to store user Redis, we have 3 Redis servers that do nothing but store these scores. We had 980 million rows in MySQL, and then we moved that to Redis. And then if I go over here, and let's say I make a change to my account, my questionnaire, blah, 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 I'll make a change. And wait for it to, it'll sit there, go out. And so right now in the background, there's that part where it's going, I enter the queue, it slurps down some information, gets me a handful of possible matches. Yeah, I'll sit there and generate my matches. And we have processes out there that are reporting in, these little workers are reporting in through Redis. They're storing all these scores in a Redis hash. And all it is like, hey, for user ID 137, with all these other user IDs, this is their score. And so if I refresh, 22% complete, and there are all these people who apparently I'm compatible with, but I'm happily married. Being married and working for a dating site's weird. Anyway, but this is real life using Redis, and so we're storing, you know, good point. Good thing it's not my problem anymore. Anyway, so but you know we calculated that our system, 3 servers, we could roughly store about 4 billion scores, and so that's how we're doing that is with Redis. And so like I said, I love MySQL, I love Postgres, I love other NoSQL solutions. I've seen people trying to use Redis for everything. I'd highly recommend against that. But when, if you have real-time data or something that you need to use that's going to be written to heavily and read from heavily, use Redis and kind of use it to augment your system, not replace your system. All right. Okay. One last question.
What durability of data are you comfortable storing? Long-term data in there?
Yeah, so the scores we feel fine storing in there because if I lose them, I can regenerate them. Sessions, I feel okay storing there because worst case scenario is the break. I kick everyone out on accident or, you know, but you can configure, say, hey, take a snapshot every 5 seconds, you know, or I take a snapshot every 1 second if you want. Or you can use the append-only file where it'll write to disk every command you've executed and so it'll take snapshots and then it'll catch it up when it reboots.
How much does that slow it down?
It, like that demo I did with all stuff, it would slow it down. It really depend on your disk. If you had like a Fusion IO card, then it probably wouldn't be a bad day. Too bad.
If you're worried about persistence of data, or you have reasons why you want to be able to do reporting on the data using SQL or something, then if you're using MySQL, look into handler socket.
Yeah. That's a great thing. That's because the slowest part about MySQL is the SQL syntax, and and so the handler socket skips a lot of that, and you interact with your tables in a more raw fashion.
You can use Redis as a memcache replacement.
Oh yes.
On boot up, if it's a cold Redis cache, can read out of the database.
Mm-hmm. We go through a warming process or whatever. You could also, they have a master-slave replication in Redis, and so you could have a system where failover to a slave, whatever. So, It's pretty cool.
One more? Sorry.
Okay, last question. No.
I'm really interested in very low cost, high traffic Google site.
Okay.
Can you recommend anything with regard to that?
Like making your stuff like more performant, like cache?
Yeah.
If you can use Redis as your cache, a lot of, and switching from interfacing with memcached is very similar to interfacing with Redis, you could switch out to use Redis very, very easily. And it's very efficient, but memcached is still really good for caching. You'll see some performance gain with Redis, but if it was a major task, then it wouldn't be as significant as if you were going from just your database to Redis, if you had no cache. No problem. So homework, go download Redis, go check out the commands. Probably the coolest documentation site I've ever seen is because they have a live demo on the documentation. It's the last thing I was gonna show, but hashes, let's see. Yeah. So in the documentation, you can test stuff out. Right on the site. I haven't figured out how they do it yet. I need to ask him how he does that. But go check it out, download, use it, try it, and have fun. Thank you so much.
Very good, thank you.